Mavis, my girl.
I love Mavis. I don't think I've read this one yet.
I love Mavis.
I read everything that was in the packet.
This is there.
Okay,
okay, welcome to the Planning Board meeting for Monday, November 21st, 2016. Thank you, HCAM, for recording the meeting today. We're missing our principal planner here, so we're going to give Jennifer a shout out at the beginning of the meeting today. She might watch the tape to make sure that we were doing the right thing today. The agenda is pretty simple today. We're going to spend most of our time on the public hearing for the master plan update. We'll get to that in about 3 or 4 minutes. Rest of it is just kind of administrative business for the board. I'd like to wish everyone a happy Thanksgiving. We have an awful lot to be thankful, particularly living here in Hopkinton, and particularly when we're about our master plan for the community and its future. So anyway, that's where it is. I would like to work on, consider the approval of the minutes for October 11th, 2016. I had one change on the back page. The top paragraph would be Mr. Weissmantel noted the planning board received the last elementary school drawings later than promised and issued the site plan decision on November 3rd. There was a couple of things about the August 22nd that just didn't make quite a sense. So as soon as we got that last drawing, we issued it within a couple of days of it and in a weekend.
Okay,
I will give you this proportion. So that would my comments. Are there any other comments to the minutes of October 11th. Seeing none, I'll entertain a motion to approve the minutes for October 11th with that one
motion.
Correction. Moved.
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carried. And here's my scribbles, Kobe. So, okay, that kind of takes care of everything. It is a formal public hearing, so let's go to the last thing on correspondence. Had a meeting with representatives of Pulte today. They have a couple of minor changes that they're going to do for the north side. One was rearranging one cul-de-sac. It's just kind of moving three duplexes around, relatively minor. Another was that to do the model homes, they're going to do a temporary installation of a forced main for the sewer. They can't get occupancy permits for those model homes, so instead of constructing the whole sewer pump station to the back of the subdivision, they're going to put those four on their own little pump station for a temporary fix to get them going for a couple months. Not that there's a lot of sewage being used by a model home other than maybe the salespeople and maybe customers, so occasionally.
Question?
Yeah.
Does the Board of Health have to approve that as well?
No, because it's part of a private sewer plant, which DEP takes care of, I believe. I mean, it's not, you know, sewage is all going to the same spot. It's going to the legacy treatment plan.
It still ends up at the treatment plant.
Yeah.
And will those be then, follow-up question, Mr. Chairman,
yeah.
Will those then be shut down after the
yes.
process is
Yes, as
completed?
Soon as the other pump station gets connected, they'll pull the pump out and do a couple of modifications to it so that it's...
So it is temporary.
It's really a temporary. And let's see, there was... Oh, and the other thing they want to do is around the model homes, they want to put a little parking area because they think that, you know, that's going to be a problem. And they're talking about a little fence and not putting the driveways in for the model homes and just kind of making that a showplace sales area. But you will see all of that probably in December or certainly by January. There was one other. They're adding a couple of new designs of homes, but that's got to go through the design review for board first.
Just going back to the parking lot, is that just a temporary parking lot?
It's a temporary as proposed. Today, I suggested, Elaine and I met with him, I said, you know, this might be a good parking lot for the school bus kids collection, so maybe we see whether, instead of making it temporary, it just stays a little bit longer or stays forever in that area.
And temporary could be 2 or 3 years, right?
Could be, yes. Oh, this temporary parking lot would be until they sold the last 400 and something units. And so at 60 or 70 a year, that's temporary, like six years. So
I'll check it though.
And then does that house get taken down, right?
No, the houses get sold as units.
I mean, even that model?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, so anyway, that's coming up. And now I see we're at 7:35, so I will open the public hearing for the master plan update. First of all, I'd like to thank all those members on the planning board, past and present, Elaine and Jen for all their work, the vision committee for all their work. I note that our town manager stated that it was kind of, well, he thought it was pretty good that the planning board accomplished this update of the master plan without hiring a consultant to do it, which many towns do. It costs sometimes hundreds of thousands of dollars. I know it's a project that we've been working on for, 3, 4 years now, I think. Lane's been doing a lot of the legwork on it. We've only been working on it in amongst all the different hearings that we've had, and this has been a very busy planning board, so it's taken a little bit longer than we had all hoped. I'd also like to thank all those members that kind of wrote or rewrote, edited the various chapters for it. In summary, the master plan includes state required chapters. This year has visioning statements on the first time, which I think added a lot to the planning board. We have a lot of updated facts and figures, how many acres are open and short, are open or built on, or how many houses, etc. In Elaine and did a lot of that work. We had an intern, I believe, one summer that helped in the first year. A lot of the facts and figures, unless somebody is here that says we've got the facts and figures wrong, and we'll take that kind of input. Most likely the key part is action plans and where we're going from it, or maybe the conclusions, and maybe we focus tonight a little bit on that. We've included a lot of photographs. We're always looking for more ideas to add some more photographs to it to make it look down. The master plan is also a kind of a top-down look at the town, as opposed to all the, you know, this is not point by point by point to implement something, but basically it's to look at it from a high vision to look down on it. So tonight we're going to focus the input on public input is the focus tonight. Then we'll have planning board discussions on, I'll say, the merits of the input. Maybe we'll do some of that tonight. And what I'd like to do is, if you're an author of a particular section, if somebody's talking to that, I want to make sure that you're engaged with the person that's providing input to that section so that you fully understand what it is. We'll spend a lot of time to make sure we understand the public comment tonight, and then if planning board members have additional comments, we'll get to our input at the end of everything else, if as opposed to making this for the public primarily today. So basically with that, I'd like to kind of open it up for committee chairmen or boards maybe to start. Do we have representatives of any committees that are out there that would like to talk from that? We received some members or some comments, written comments from various committees and chairmen. Sir, please state your name and address.
My name is Christopher McFall. I live on 19 Missouri Street. Mm-hmm. As you know, that intersection is unbelievably bad, right on Main and Wood. So the lights right there in Missouri is in between Hockington Lumber and DC. I've lived in the town just over 7 years, and I believe that that intersection and that main road has been getting busier and busier and busier every year. This year, it's getting to be to the point where it's taking up to 10 minutes just to get out of the end of the street. You know, the white box is there. Nobody follows that. We all know. People park on it all the time. Plus, we have all the NGC staff and all the parents dropping off and then leaving. So then you've got 10, 15 cars. Like, it's not a big street, you know, and it's tough to get out. The other end, also with the school buses, I have a 5-year-old who use the school bus system, and they drop off at the top of that street. And cars, actually, I think they don't realize coming through the red light, green light, that there's a bus stopped, that the red light's flashing and the stop sign out, and they're just flying past. So, you know, there's 4 or 5 kids living on that street to get off that same bus, and they take it every morning. They also jump the curb. It's right there. If anybody has noticed right where the red box is, there's a flat curb. It's not very big. It's a sidewalk. And people literally drive over the top of it. I stand at the end of the street to pick my kid up. And every day, there's at least one or two will drive over the top of that curb to go down, do it towards Wood Street. I know that everybody that lives in that area, those little streets, it's a nightmare to get out of. So I would like to know what the plans are for the reconstruction, because I hear there is going to be reconstruction of that intersection. And is that going to help Missouri Street and the people who live on it be able to get in and out and not have to worry about it? Is there going to be a light put in so we can get in and out, so NGCC can use it? You know, so I would just like to know where we're going with that.
Maybe I'll take a quick answer on that. What I believe is we're in the transportation corridor study for state funding for fiscal year 2019, which will go all the way from that, the Wood West Main Street intersection to basically Ash Street. There's not a light proposed for Missouri Street. It's too close to the other light, I believe. Dave Del Torio has got the plans and the latest version of it. He's the town engineer. Mm-hmm. I believe the state will have a 25% design review, I won't say shortly, but it's got to be shortly because they're running out of time to get it, the construction going on that. And with that, you'll see all the details. Certainly the issues of curbs and stuff like that, I'm pretty sure, get resolved with that state funding.
Yeah, well, the curb alone, what's going to happen is going to be a dead kid, you know what I mean? So I'm at that point where I'm like worrying about my kid. I have another one on the way, so we're going to be using the bus service.
Yep.
Coming up for years to come. And it just takes one person to drive over that and wipe them all out. It needs to be addressed. There's no issue of, oh, well, got it. It needs to be sorted out.
I think everyone in town realizes that the Main Street corridor is one of our major traffic concerns, and I think we've implemented that in the plan. Who wrote the transportation section? That was Matt. You've got that in there, I believe.
It's a priority. It's been recognized, and as Ken mentioned, It really hinges on this state transportation initiative.
I guess you said 2019 was the date. I know that's not comforting to you.
I think the money actually becomes available in 2018. It's the state is paying for the entire Burrell.
Is there a cheaper version of being able to do it? Like, that curb needs to be sorted out. That sidewalk needs to be either higher, painted. There needs to be signs out, like, even in the middle of the street, like they do at, shopping malls.
Okay.
They have it sitting right there. You know, it's against the law.
Yeah.
Blah, blah, blah.
Why don't we kind of maybe take a note and pass that one on to the selectman, Elaine, so that the town engineer, maybe in DPW, that, you know, for a temporary fix.
A temporary cheaper fix that can be.
You might be able to put a sign kind of in that sidewalk area that will keep the cars from running over it.
Sure. Would be nice.
Yeah.
If okay. I may, from
yeah,
the chair.
Sure.
Have you represented anybody else on that on your street?
We're all behind it. All our neighbors, there's only 9 houses on the street, but there's 5 kids. So, almost be 6. And they're all behind us, but, you know,
sure.
I didn't find out about this meeting until I got a phone call, so I don't know, like, this is my first time at one of these meetings, so it's very hard to know what your meetings are, unless you're literally going online to the actual website. There should be some sort of, you know, be a last email that can go out. You guys can call us when there's an emergency. Should be some way of doing a last email, so we all know, so we can all come out and we can all talk and say our piece. You know, we all live here. People, you know, fair taxes.
Elaine, did you explain if you want to get on? There's a way to sign up for.
You can subscribe to receive all agendas and notices through the town website.
But does everybody know that? That's my question.
Yeah,
yeah. I mean, it's,
you know,
it's,
does everybody in town actually know that? Is there been a sense? Has there been?
You should subscribe. I mean, spread the word.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Right. If I may.
Yeah.
To address Chris's concerns. There is a historical concern there, and one of the reasons that the curb is the way it is to slow people down from going onto Wood Street. I think that's one of the reasons it's not a real stone curb. It's a tar curb, which gets people driving over it sometimes. But the current issue is that there's a safety concern, and I know the police are often at, like, say, the lumber store parking lot, but they're not close enough to see maybe people that are in the parking block area, not parking at white blocks.
I've been at that since the school started, and there's only been a police. I pick my kid up 5 days a week. There's only been a police officer every time. Since the school started.
At the lumber store? Or?
Right where the curb is.
Oh, at where the.
Yeah. That's where they sit. So nobody's going to do anything in front of them, right?
So longer term, like something that we could help with, or the board of selectmen, or the town engineer. But the faster answer is maybe communicate with the police that maybe that, sure, it's great that they're at the lumber store, but maybe they should have someone more there right in the intersection to see some of the issues that you're seeing.
Yep.
And anything we could do to help, we can.
Okay.
Well, I mean, the signage, and maybe the sign could be moved over too. It's like over in the corner. It's like miles away from the actual road. Yes. You're not allowed to park in the white box.
Okay. So. Next comment. All the way in the back.
They come up to the microphone.
Yeah.
You can hear them.
Oh, yeah, there's a microphone right up here.
If you, I can yell.
Not, the TV people would love to hear you better.
We already have plenty of people in town yelling.
Yeah. Yes. Just, we got a comfortable chair, too. Thank you.
I'm Peggy Barton from Sanctuary Lane. And just in general, I would love to see this. It seems like a mad building frenzy to just stop and preserve whatever and we have left and keep it open space as much as possible. And if we're ever presented with an offer for land, just scoop it up because it's a limited resource, we know, and that's the end of the line with it. So we're already at overcapacity on the roads, it seems, and it just seems on and on and on. And just saying, keep the space there and the trees and the sky. That's it.
Thank you, Peggy. Thank you. We received an email from her also.
Yeah, just a comment. I think she might be referring to Legacy Farms, and that was offered the town first choice of refusal, and the town voted to turn it down, which is, to your point, try to save more preserve some more land.
Yeah. John?
I chair the Open Space Committee, and we are looking at, we don't have the ability to buy everything that comes available, so what we're trying to do is concentrate in two areas. One is adding on to what we have, rather than having a pockets here or there that people are utilizing. And the second is also looking at any land that's necessary to protect your water supply. So priority is going there. And if there are larger opportunities that have a, or special cases, you know, we'll look at it. But what we're trying to do is really concentrate on expanding what we have. So it's an area that many people can use smaller parcels. Nobody's utilizing and enjoying the open space.
If I may, for the chair, Peggy's a member of the Sustainable Green Committee, and that's a probably a good place to start to maybe identify the smaller parcels that could be of use to the open space.
Okay. Okay. Next comment.
Go. So you guys probably largely know me as having been associated with the Upper Charles Trail Committee.
Why don't you say
yes?
Name and address.
So my name is Ken Parker. I'm the vice chair currently of the Upper Charles Trail Committee, but I'm also an active member of the Hopkinton Trails Club. And my main focus has been basically promoting paths in town in association with bike trail potentially, but also just between various developments. And what I'd like people to concentrate, to think about, is that I believe the town needs to pay more attention to having somebody in the town government making sure that we have an overall vision of connecting every new development to all of the various destinations in town, like the high school, the library, in a way so as to promote both foot traffic and bike traffic when it's possible, so as to ameliorate our horrible traffic situation, which is focused on just a small number of through streets. And it would be, in my opinion, much better if there was ways to walk between the various new developments in town to downtown, so as to decrease that burden on all those streets. Another issue has to do with making sure that when developers promise open land and trails, that they actually follow through on their pledge. So on that note, Legacy Farms South there's been some new developments there where they've now placed some of the new trails that they had promised just in the last week. And I see that as a positive step forward. I don't know whether that's the end of the game there. I hope it isn't, because those trails right now dead end in backyards of the various condos, and that's not an ideal situation. And there's other places where the Legacy Farm South Trail, for example, goes right through land that is currently flooded in spite of our drought. And that's because they were positioned in old nursery roads rather than on higher land next to those nursery roads, which would have made for a much more usable trail system. So those are my comments.
Ken?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Are you able to take some pictures of that?
I didn't take any pictures, but if you walk on the Legacy Farm South Trails right now, there are multiple places where there's probably 6 inches of water blocking access.
From this last rain?
It's amazing. This time of year, you know, I guess the pores start closing down and the water doesn't drain away. And in spite of the drought, I'd say a good portion of those trails are underwater. And you know they're not inaccessible to somebody who's willing to get their feet a little wet or wear hiking boots to keep your feet dry. Or what I do is walk off the trail into the meadow on the side, which is higher. Anyway, there are ways around.
Yeah, the Legacy Trails are not even on the south side finished. It from I think our standpoint, they were always kind of a work in progress, and now we're. The housing stuff is pretty well set. We've got to work on finishing it. I know we have a meeting with Roy, and a plan coming up with him on the north side for planning on the north parcel. So, yeah, we're a little worried about the ones that we're responsible for.
Sure.
But your points about connecting and walkability, I think, has been the focus of this board in the last 5 or 6 years.
I mean, the master plan.
We're getting better.
You know, at that level, I don't have any real objections to anything in the master plan. I think you guys did a great job writing it and all.
Yeah. Okay.
One more comment too. That I think you're probably aware that the I totally agree with you. By the way, first of all, more trails the better. But the new school has a trail system incorporated all around it and connecting to existing trails. And the Legacy North, there's going to be a substantial trail system in that as well. So
I've seen the plans. You know, the plans often look good. Although in the case of the elementary school, I haven't seen details of any trails connecting out to the neighborhood next to that elementary school. Rather, the trails I've seen have been kind of interior to the land. That doesn't really do a lot of good, in my opinion.
Have you talked with Jane at all, with the Upper Charles?
Sure, I'm on the Upper Charles.
Yeah, so you understand that is all being cohesively worked in, and they're in the process of making that all connect, right? You understand?
Well, what I've seen is a trail system, you know, that goes along basically the east side of New Elementary School, but without any focus on connecting from that east side trail to neighborhoods next to there. And so what I'm saying is that it's all fine and good to have a way to walk along the east side of the elementary school, but if you can't get to the neighborhoods near there, then you're not promoting walkability in a meaningful way.
Are you referring to the neighborhoods east of that? Like
correct.
Blueberry.
Right. Yeah. So we've got this new development that's in planning there. I don't know what the stages of that are, and maybe that'll be addressed when those plans, you know, progress.
Jane, but to Cliff's point, Jane did attend our sessions, and she described to us how it's connected from the south and from the north. But you bring up a good point: it's not connecting to the east to the neighborhood.
It's not necessarily even connected to the south. It may be, but
eventually it will.
Yeah, I think they have a plan.
They have a plan.
Well, they're working on it. Let's put it, the planning process is in process.
Right.
So,
okay, I understand what you're saying.
Another place is the Muse. I keep emphasizing that you know, we've got a whole lot of new people that are going to be moving into the Muse development off Lumber Street, and just want to emphasize that I think that there's a perfect opportunity to make a connecting walking trail to the high school area from there.
There's already existing trails in there.
That's correct.
Historically,
it's a matter of affirming those trails.
Yeah, I don't think they'll get washed over.
Well, they won't get washed over. What I want is them to be publicized so that people don't feel, you know, and for their little bit of maintenance money to be spent.
Well, with the job that you're doing, Ken, in on the board and everything, and the way that Jane is working and everybody else is working, I think you guys are doing a great job. And
in the case of the Muse, that's really not the folks of the Upper Charles Trail Committee at all.
No, I mean, but connecting trails is.
Right.
Right.
Right. Let me take this in a little bit different way here.
Okay.
We got an email from Jane Moran, who's chairman of the Upper Charles Committee, and she basically said the Upper Charles Committee met last night and discussed one suggestion we thought the planning board might want to consider adding to the master plan. Page 60, item 8, we thought it might be useful to recommend a new oversight body within town government that would be responsible for the development, maintenance, and oversights of trails on public land. If you had it with that larger scope than the Upper Charles, then I think a lot of the things that Ken Parker was saying would get accomplished.
That's
something we ought to take into consideration. Yes. Yeah.
Just one comment on the views, which I was very surprised to find that it's a 40B plan. So if board does not have any input at all, because we would not have allowed above ground wires there. If you take a drive through there, it's pretty much an eyesore. Above ground utilities.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we didn't get a shot at looking at any of that, including trails corrected and wrong.
Yeah. I think there are some trails on the eastern side of the Muse property, but a lot of the trails that would have to commute, there's still 100 acres between the Muse and, I'll say, the
center trail
area, and that part is an undefined process, and that land is, I'm going to say, open for development at this particular point. I mean, it's, I'm sure it will be done something. I mean, I believe the owner is marketing it as we speak.
A question for Dr. Parker?
Sure.
Ken?
You're also a member of the Sustainable Green Committee and the Upper Trails Trail Committee. You mentioned also earlier that there should be someone in government that has oversight.
Aligned to what Jane said, yeah.
In Jane's letter saying, you know, some committee. Historically, we had the Trails Committee, and then that was decommissioned as a town committee, and then there's Parks and Rec, and then there's Upper Trails Trail Committee. But Ken says there's a scope issue. Do you think we need a new committee, or do you think we need someone in town already that should have oversight?
I think there should be someone in town government who's got who's effectively responsible for that. That would be the ideal, in my opinion, but it's just my opinion.
And so who would that person be today?
Because of the DPW,
Park and Rec,
open
space.
I mean,
go ahead, Jeff. I think the issues we have, and you brought up a very good point, is that there are different committees with different powers, with different responsibilities. So even though open space can acquire the land, they have no money to necessarily maintain it or to develop trails. So I think it's either a look at revamping everything we have and seeing what the most effective way of doing it is, or a coordinating body to do it. But one of the problems is everybody here is active in the town, but you go outside and there's not a lot of people who are active. So one of my concerns is maybe it's reorganizing what we have or increasing the power we have. Because I'm not quite sure if you're going to staff something new if there's enough people to be involved.
Okay. Let's take some more input. Joe, I think I saw your hand up there. Come on down.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hello, everyone. Kobe, sorry I didn't send comments in writing in advance, but I know you're going to get it all down, right? I have just a few comments. First, I'm a big fan of the document. I think that the town does a really good job on this master plan update every 5 years, and it's just so well written, and it has kind of vision backed by, you know, concrete steps and measures to get there. A couple parts that I really like are the sidewalk section. It was strong in the prior versions of this document, and it's strong again. And I think, you know, largely because of that, we had a lot of because of the strength of which that part's written, it gave us a lot of ability to go to town meeting the past few years to get funding for sidewalks, and I think that's really dramatically improved things in various parts of town. So I hope we can continue to do that. The other part that I liked was on the facilities section, I wanted to make sure there was a specific call out for the center school reuse. And I saw there is a paragraph in there about the adaptive reuse of center school. And I'm glad to see even some suggested uses that should be considered. So those are two that I was looking for. I wanted to ask if in the transportation section or elsewhere, is there anything in here about that the downtown roadway improvement project and plan? Because that's one that's been lingering for, you know, on 10 years maybe of trying to get something done to improve the look and utility of the downtown roadways and sidewalks and everything about it.
We've got the downtown corridor, and I think we even asked, and I don't know whether we got it in this version or not, but at our last meeting we talked about starting a Hayden Row corridor based on, you know, looking at all the traffic studies and maybe calming and efficiency improvements for that one, because that'll be the next one that's hitting us, as you know.
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Is that in here?
It should be.
That would be good.
The downtown corridor is in the land use section.
Okay.
And Joe, just to give you a highlight of it, it includes three pieces. One is the redesign of the intersection between Hayden Row or Grove Street, Main Street. That's point number one. Point two is to build the combination sidewalk bike path through the center of town. And number three is, somebody help me out.
Well, it's the entire
corridor.
Underground utilities.
Underground utilities.
Mm. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And that's all. That's in here. That's good.
Yes.
All
right. And I think at this point that's kind of proceeding on its own relatively slow pace with the state, because it is most of it is funded by the state. Maybe there's some things we as a town will have to pay for, probably undergrounding of utilities.
And the 2019 time frame is for to satisfy the state too. For those funds.
Okay.
And I think, given that I've testified at the state level on that the last time around for the town, the fact that we're starting to really do something about the intersection at Grove Cedar and Main Street and realigning that will get us enough points. We've been on the bubble on the state funding from that, and we've been pushed back a couple of years because we didn't have that part worked on. The selectmen are working hard on that as we speak. So
okay.
We're hoping that gets done real quick. The other point I kind of note for just other information is probably within the next month or two, we'll be opening up Legacy North, which will take some of the pressure off of the downtown traffic snarl at the evening rush hour.
Okay.
Just to add on to that, what Cam was saying, with that intersection of 85 and 135, the selectmen did 2 to 4 weeks ago vote to move forward with the taking of the land and are trying to work with the owners to agree upon a price for that land to straighten out 85.
Okay. Yeah, I see in the action plan on page 71 in this draft that you mentioned 85, 135. Even though it's a separate project, I think it's good to include it in here to kind of give it additional momentum. And on that note, you're right, Ken, that corridor on Hayden Row between the Grove Street intersection and Chestnut, at least, you know, I know the DPW put forth a plan that people had issues with a few years ago at town meeting, but if there's anything we can put in here to give them the political ammunition they need to have the confidence to bring something back. I think the town wants something done on Hayden Row, and absolutely, it just wasn't done the right way at that town meeting a couple of years ago.
It wasn't explained well.
Right.
I don't know what they were trying to do, but
something.
Yeah.
So number four there on the transportation goals, we do have.
Okay.
Yeah. So what does that read?
Improve the Hayden Row corridor to provide safe and efficient traffic flow and pedestrian and bicycle access to schools and neighborhoods.
Okay.
Good. The last and final one is something in here about the Irvine Pizarro study group recommendation and make sure we do the right thing with that land.
There is something there's a section that says we got to study those two and the Pratt property and come up with master plans for each of them.
Yeah.
So, which I think are underway, but
okay,
they aren't so done yet.
We might want to explain to the audience where the properties are.
I think
Pratt is on Street.
Yeah.
Cadero is just south of the new school. Is that correct?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Waterfresh, right?
So then the land use section talks about completing and presenting those plans to town meeting
for approval.
For approval.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you for bringing it up, Joe.
Yeah.
Appreciate
right.
it.
Thanks.
Take a good look at it. Yeah.
I'll read the whole thing. Thanks.
Yeah. other comments, questions? Sir, come on up.
Hi, folks. Mike Paldiuca, 5 Carriage Hill Road. My wife and I wanted to come down and first of all thank you for the work that you did a few years ago on the Ash Street sidewalk. We use it constantly. My kids use it constantly. You've been fantastic and coached me through the whole process. Thank you, Elaine. If you haven't taken a walk on that sidewalk, please do. I mean, you should feel really good about it. The reason we came down was to thank you for that and also inquire about the plans, as these last two gentlemen spoke about, as far as the cut-through streets and how those are going to be incorporated into the future plan for the connecting these major arteries and the overall sidewalk plan. So the one that comes to mind is Holt. We see a lot of kids walking up and down Holt at the end of the day. If you've taken a walk up and down Hope, it actually narrows to the point where two cars and a pedestrian can't pass at one point, and it's without snow on the ground. So I would recommend that someone take a look at that particular intersection where it peaks and then dips and turns and narrows all in the same spot. It's kind of dangerous.
We looked at Holt, and it kind of almost made the cut for the... We've been asked by the DPW, aside from this, to kind of put the priority for additional sidewalks in the next budget request. The last time, I think, that, including the Ash Street plus a bunch of other sidewalks, was about $1.5 million worth of capital improvements. We got some engineering money last town meeting to work on some more sidewalks. We did, I think the priority was the eastern side of Hayden Row Street near the new school area, mm-hmm. which we felt was key, and then also trying to get across Main Street from, I'll say, from Lumber Street past the Price Chopper along in that area, which is as much as Holt is, and I travel Holt almost on a daily basis. Holt could use a sidewalk, but I would not walk along Main Street to get across that area.
Or West Main Street.
Yeah, that, or West Main Street. I mean, we did the Main Street to Lumber Street with that last bit of money. But I would just like to make a comment that I think we've seen a change in sidewalks, and maybe this is where the attitude of the town is, and we've reflected a little bit of this in the master plan. I would say the last version of the master plan 7 years ago was we were into a lot of rural character entirely. And I think we're seeing with the sidewalks and where we're putting sidewalks in and we're retrofitting sidewalks in, that we've gone from kind of a full rural character. We like the feel of it, but we want the safety of suburban sidewalks, I think. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, when we did the Ash Street one, and I'm an Ash Street resident, you know, it was tough to cut down the trees that we had to cut down to make the sidewalk there. Now, I'm not sure you see those trees other than those of us on the planning board that signed death warrants for a bunch of trees, that most people there don't see them or miss them as much, partly because there's a lot of trees on people's private property that kind of keeps a lot of the look and feel of it. But I sense, and I don't know whether, you know, please, you know, I'm throwing this out as an opinion, not a fact, is I sense that there's a change from the pure rural character to now a little bit more suburban character, but we still want it to look kind of like it used to. Mm. But we want some of the, I'll say, the amenities of safety. And I know even the Commonwealth, you know, bike lanes and bike complete streets are really the word that was there. And I think I've felt the difference just serving on this board for 10 years where, you know, bicycles were just part of a small part of the community, as opposed to now everyone would really like it a lot safer. I mean, I guess as a kid I drove in the street with my bicycle, but we wouldn't do that these days now, I mean, as much. So,
well, you almost have to now because we can't ride bicycles on sidewalks because it's pedestrian.
Yeah.
So, and but, I can attest to what Ken just said, is that I've already been hit by a car by riding my bicycle.
Yeah.
So
it's, yeah, it's, so anyway, that's just a sense that I have, that we've kind of changed. And I think this document in many ways kind of reflects that change.
Ken,
yeah.
So I've only been on the board 6 months, but Ken and anybody else's board can tell you that I'm a huge sidewalk advocate. I'm always pushing for sidewalks. And I looked at what the DPW is doing, and for the sidewalks we just got done, you alluded to that we spent like $1.5 million, it turns out to be $850 per foot. So it's very expensive in my mind. So I've kind of challenged, I met with Norman, town manager, about a month ago, and he's going to try to work with DPW. I don't know if it's possible or not, but a cheaper way to do it, can we do it ourselves? You know what I mean? Can we rent a curbing machine? Because one of the big issues is a curbing machine. So I'd like to find a way to do it cheaper so we can build a lot more, because we have spent a lot of money in just those little bit sections that we've done recently.
And he is really committed. Well, and I appreciate it.
Yeah.
A lot of them are retrofit,
but a lot of them are difficult to get in. I mean, like getting through the 495, that's going to cost a lot of money.
Well, I saw what they encountered on Ash with ledge and things like that. I mean, in the end, and I agree with everything you said. So I lived, we've been in town 20 plus years. We lived in this house for 6. And I can tell you, walking on that sidewalk, I have noticed things about those houses from an architecture standpoint, from just the way they do their lawns, the way they're set back off the road. I found a house I didn't even know existed. Just because I'm always driving up and down the road, I'm not looking into the woods. And I think there's dozens and dozens of people who walk up and down that road constantly. So I agree with you. I think there is a little bit of a trade-off right now. And connecting the sidewalks together, I think, is a part of that. Like this gentleman was saying with the paths, maybe there's a way to do it where you connect through Blueberry up to the schools through that neighborhood where people can walk a little bit more safely. Because I hate to play the danger card, but if you walk on Old Street when those kids get out of high school, it's a rough, rough place to walk. Mm-hmm. And I tell my kids, don't walk down Holt Street, take a couple steps up and come down Pike. You know, you're going to be much safer. And it's the right message, but it's the wrong message.
Yeah.
At one point, too, it's not just downtown. If you look at Spring Street, the Food Street, there is a tremendous amount of traffic coming into Brockton and up into Framingham and Boston. Mm-hmm. I drive by people all the time walking in the street, and I just feel bad for them because it's dangerous. So we need to do it in lots of places.
Well, I appreciate what you did. I mean, I think, again, please feel good about it. There's dozens and dozens of people, including my wife and I and my boys, who use that sidewalk regularly. I thank you for it. Anything you can do for the cut-through streets, including both, would be greatly appreciated.
If I can, Mr. Chair?
Yeah, go ahead, Frank.
Thank you. It's always good to hear good feedback. And your information about Holt, I think it kind of jabs with what I've seen. It could be a little bit tight. And speaking for myself, we'll keep that in mind. I'll keep that in mind as we move forward.
Thank you. I appreciate it. If you check out where you'll see where it comes together if you don't know it already.
Is that the dip in the end?
Thankfully, the mail truck doesn't park there anymore because that used to make it a little bit worse. But the gentleman was kind enough to move it someplace else when he has to do the deliveries.
Is that on the Ash Street side or the Hayden Row side?
It's between Ash and Hayden Row on the Main Street side. So if it's facing downtown.
Oh, on Ash Street.
On Holt.
On Holt Street. Holt doesn't hit Main Street, though.
But it's on that side of Holt Street. So Hayden it connects Ash to Hayden Row.
Yes.
And then it's on the, what would that be, the north side?
It's on north side.
North side.
North side.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks, folks.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming. Other comments? Come on down.
Hi. My name's Nanda Barker Hook, and my address is 75 Grove Street. And I just wanted to say, I think there's lots of excellent things in this document, and I really like it. And I think two key elements to the success of a master plan like this is communications and periodic assessment. So I'm curious, what plan is in place? Is there a plan in place to share this really with everybody in the town? How can we make it accessible? How can we get everybody to see it and understand it? And also, is there periodic assessment sort of built into the schedule until this is reviewed again in X number of years? I don't know when it's going to be up for renewal, but you know, how are we sort of going to monitor and keep track of our progress?
Good questions. From the communication standpoint, it is on the town website in a draft form at this point. It's a document that we keep from a town planning standpoint. You know, a lot of questions, if a developer is coming in, one of the questions usually is in site plan review, is it in keeping with the master plan? And so we use that, I think, a little bit of in guidance when you're trying to figure out which way to go with something. I think people that are buying a piece of property might also use it as guidance as to, you know,
I got another idea. Well, their another idea might be something that is clearly not in the master plan, and maybe they can figure out by reading through that that, you know, it's not something that would probably meet this board and certainly town hall staff and meeting with people who are contemplating something like that, you know, get that. It's also kind of guidance for the Zoning Advisory Committee, which is working on zoning laws. And for every town meeting, we pick a one or two. For example, this last town meeting, we had a couple that dealt with housing. Well, we had already written that section of the housing. We recognized that we kind of met our quota for affordable housing. We met our significant increase in the amount of condos in the last, with Legacy Farms and a couple other ones. And so we kind of proposed to put the moratorium on the garden apartments, which was passed at last town meeting. So we kind of, those started off a year ago. They were implementation goals in the section, and we kind of sprung ahead with that because we as the small board saw where we were headed with those and got town meeting to go ahead without having the whole plan done. So it's kind of, it's many ways it's a living document. We've been working on it for 4 years or so, and you know we're a couple years late, and because you're supposed to update it every 5 years. Now we've been kind of updating it in draft form for the last 4 years, and even, you know, before we released this draft, we had to say, you know, that the school construction was underway, the library is underway, the DPW. I mean, there's a bunch of, I'll say, facts that got changed, you know, at the last bit. So I guess it's part of the town website, and if you're a developer in town, you usually know to kind of talk to the staff, and the staff in the land use department, I know, points people towards this type of stuff. Periodic assessments, I believe it's, is it state law that we're supposed to try to update this every 5 years, or is it recommendation? Or?
It's our own internal.
Oh, it's our own, okay, it's our own.
No state requirement.
No state requirement. State requirement gives the responsibility for making a master plan to the planning board. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of our, that's why we're doing it as opposed to selectmen or another committee. And we've had a 5-year goal, I guess. And did we meet? The last one was 2007. So we're well beyond our where we want. We started it for the 12th, and then we got busy with Legacy Farms and some of these other ones that took meetings after meetings after meetings. We made a conscious decision not to, to sub it out to some other planning organization and spend a lot of money and for the sake of getting done. I think it's a lot better document because we did it ourselves, because everyone knows the community better than whoever we could hire.
Okay.
Except for maybe Elaine, who's worked here so long that she could live here.
So, Mr. Chairman, yeah. I have a thought on this, and maybe it's piggybacking off the comment that Ms. Barker-Hook mentioned, is we should almost have a PR campaign in some degree to be able to articulate what this is about to the members of the community and the members of the town. And if it's once every 5 years, people move in, people move out, people aren't aware of it, you could do it at multiple levels. You could do it in the Independent, Op News. You can put a commentary out so you can figure out some way to use a vehicle. And then in terms of accountability, I think we have to hold our own selves accountable. I think we've done a decent job with that, but every 5 years, hey, year four, this is what we need to do. And, you know, communicate out to the town in year four, this is what we're working on, to get feedback throughout the process. So it becomes that living, breathing document you talked about, but incorporates the feedback and the thoughts of the townspeople. So as we're writing the individual chapters, we're incorporating those elements. So just a thought. I mean, it's something to that.
If I may, Ken?
Yeah.
To ride on his back and yours as well, first of all, my question would be, do you have any suggestions on the questions that you pose as solutions? That if you could just hold that for a second. And then the second thing that I want to bring up is that it is, in my mind, as a board member, and why I came onto the board, was the fact that I thought and felt that there needed to be more communication between all committees across the entire town. And in order to do that, we needed more resident participation. Now, my first question when I became a board member was, how do we create, with today's technology, what we have at our disposal? Why? The stamp is obsolete, and it costs money, but emails don't. And why aren't we utilizing that? Instead of saying, look, we have a town website that people can go on, or if you're in town hall, you get a chance. Chairman Weissmantel said that most of the developers in town know that they need to go and ask certain X, Y, and Z people. Well, the typical individual resident has no clue about that. And so I think that there's a disconnect in that. So with that bit of knowledge on my aspect in correlation to what you're asking, I ask you again now.
Can you hold that for 1 second?
Sure.
I want your comments, but I just wanted to, because Chris has mentioned this to me a few times too, and I've been thinking about it, and let me tell you what I do in my neighborhood. I live over on Spring Street as well. So I've kind of become the webmaster for my neighborhood. I've gone to people, connections, emails from other people. I've actually knocked on people's doors and got email. So I can disseminate information to 50 houses.
Yeah.
And I do it very frugally. I do a blind carbon copy, so there's no reply at all. And, you know, about silly things like cat missing, whatever, you know, found my cat, that, all that kind of stuff. But funny emails, people don't want to see that. They just want to see one email with information.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we can move forward, like getting a neighborhood representative, I will call it, onto the distribution list that they can then push it out, because we don't want to maintain 7,000 emails. It'd be hard to do because emails change all the time. People come and people go. So I would look for somebody like you to take initiative in your area of the downtown and maybe get together a list that you could be the person that could push out that information once you get it.
Well, so interesting that you say that, because I sort of turned into my communications person for my neighborhood, the upper end of Grove Street, and we just have an email list. I think that I definitely feel like there's a disconnect, and that's why I brought it up. And I feel like this is an excellent document, and the more people that understand it and are a part of it, then more everybody's going to buy in, the town is going to buy into this and really see this as everyone's vision for the future of the town. And I think in terms of communications, I mean, there's so many ways to get the message out. Social media obviously is huge, much bigger, I think, than email nowadays. But there's email, there's public forums, inside and outside of town hall, press releases, working with local publications. So it kind of raises the question, we have a master plan in terms of land use and development. Perhaps we should have a master plan in terms of communications and technology. Because while this is available on the town website, when I talk to people about it, people are not aware of it. They don't just regularly go to the town website to look for updates. They need to be...
It's hard to find on the website.
It is hard to find.
Right. So people need to be sort of prompted, like, oh, this relates to my daily life, and so I'm going to read this document. Or, you know, even there needs to be summaries, you know, to make all of this information. This is a huge document, and if you have the time to read the whole thing, great. But for many people, they need to have it in digestible sound bites that are put out often. You know, that's what we use social media for. So there's a lot of opportunity for growth there.
Right.
But the other piece too is just what I heard, I think, from what you said, was there isn't really an assessment built in until 5 years from now. And so my recommendation, I don't know exactly what that would look like, but to build in some sort of periodic, annual, let's see how we're doing on all of these action items. Having some sort of meeting and public hearing on an annual basis to see how we're moving ahead.
There were a couple of key ones I know we put in our action plan where there was like a yearly report to selectmen on housing stock, I think was the new thing.
And in the back you have a placeholder for an implementation plan. And so you can turn that into, you know, however you want to keep track of something. So there's a timeline, responsible party, and then a checklist, an annual or 6 month checklist for each of the action items.
Yeah, good ideas.
If I can through the chair?
Yeah.
So, and then you volunteer a lot in town, so sometimes it's a question of who volunteers and who's involved. Not everyone knows everything about how the town works, and so one of the things in our section was we wanted to include more transparency in how to do and connect with the town for projects and any questions that come up. And part of the answer for that is we have a IT director in town who is supposedly redesigning the website from the way it is, which is clunky at best to get information. If you know where to get the information, then it's there, it's solid. But if you don't know where to get something and you're looking for something, it's not too clear. So we'd like to work with our IT director. I think I met the guy once, and maybe that's something we could use to promote the master plan on the town website. Still, it's still talking just on the website side of things. But it's a little bit, how much time do we have? And we're trying to make things better. Maybe a yearly review looking back, how much did we accomplish? And are we doing a better job this year than we did last year concerning the master plan implementation? And that's a good suggestion.
Yeah.
That point, if I may, Ken, one last thing, is that I think each aspect that you brought up feeds off the other one. And the first one is the communication aspect. Because what happens is the more we communicate with residents that don't know how to navigate through our website or don't frequent the town for postings on when meetings are, that the more we intertwine the residents into that aspect, the more volunteers we're going to get, the more proactive people are going to become. If we don't offer a way to make it easier for the public to look at us, then we're blind, and they're blind. So that is my point, and I'm going to stand steadfast on that for my next four and a half years.
I agree with you. Yeah, I agree with you. And one last thing, is just so you all know, there's an organization in town that I'm on the board of, EHOP. Many of you are familiar. And so our mission is to get information out to people so that we have more of an engaged, informed, citizenship in our town. So we actually promoted this hearing through our networks today.
Wonderful.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
One other question that you kind of brought up, maybe I'll just bring it up. No, first of all, before we do that, other comments, questions from people out that came. Come on up. Come on down.
Everybody has to come up for it.
You came for a reason.
I'm Emily Pilat, 67 Front Street. I think a couple of my comments would be to really pay attention to development going forward. Obviously, we all know more. There's a development problem. We have a huge traffic problem. It's a humongous problem, in my opinion. We moved here 6 years ago to the weekend, this coming weekend, and the changes we've seen in 6 years are disheartening, to be quite honest, of how things have changed. We personally are like the rural character, and the traffic on our road with cut-through has just gone completely out of control. It's really unfortunate. So I know that obviously things have, plots of land have been purchased in the past and developed in a certain way, but my recommendation going forward would be to pay a lot of attention to how they are zoned, because, for instance, Legacy Farms did not need to be zoned the way it ended up being zoned, and that could have made a big difference on how things kind of played out. So I think that's...
Actually, Legacy Farms could have had three times the number of units if we didn't zone it the way it was.
Yeah, I mean...
And that's under the zoning that was before Legacy, you could almost get 3,000 units on there.
I believe it.
I mean, because as it is, we're developing 200 out of 700 acres with 1,000 units, so...
Yeah, I mean, I guess... Before, obviously, as we were arriving, it was already said, but I personally would have liked to have seen it, you know, more single family, larger plot, that sort of thing. I think would have helped, obviously, because it's so much land, would have helped to really
The real problem to get back, and then this is 10, 12 years ago, that Joe Markey and some of us have been around for a while, was that we had the 40B hanging over us at the time, and we could have gotten creamed on a 40B situation on that whole area because we didn't meet our affordable housing. And when you've got that threat hanging over you, you can't, you know, zoning is thrown out of the, you know, that's the state law, zoning is thrown out, and town people made a deal. And we had quite a bit of involvement 11 years ago with meetings in neighborhoods and all over the place. I mean, it was a big deal, and the town ended up making a decision truly as a town not to buy it and to make the deal with Mr. McDowell. And we've literally, as a planning board for 10 years, have been kind of enforcing the deal that was made.
And Mr. Chair, that's no longer an issue because of reviews, and we've satisfied our 40B?
We've got our 40B. We're over our 10%. That's something that I don't think 11 years ago I thought we'd ever make it, but we got where we are, and I think we're in good shape till actually 2030, but we have to look at that every so often.
Yeah, I mean, I just think going forward, it's just obviously it's important to pay attention to how it's done, because I feel like we're kind of bursting at the seams a bit.
I just wanted to make one comment to your point. Legacy South to the, and I can feel that it seems like a lot of houses. What I've seen for the plans for Legacy North is it's very different because of the landscape of the land, because there's pretty much five individual neighborhoods. I think it's going to look a lot different, in my opinion. Only time will tell. But
I'm mostly concerned about
volume. I don't disagree with that. I think it's going to look like the South and the North look a lot the same, except for it's a little bit slopy. The land is a little bit better. But
through the chair, I think this board learned from the past how to maybe handle Legacy Farms North better than the South. I just want to say we a lot of people have shared your concerns about overbuilding, and it's something we think about when we... Yeah.
The other thing, I think if you look at both the housing section and maybe the land use, what we've seen, particularly where we were able to control the garden apartment, which is the condo portion at this point, and we eliminated that at the last town meeting, unless we get down below our 10%, the big single-family subdivisions that were built in the 90s and the early part of this year, we just aren't seeing many of those. You know, we haven't, as a board, I can't remember the last 40, I don't think in my 10 years I've done a 40-unit subdivision. I've done some 20s, I think. I'm trying to remember what the biggest one I've done in the last 10 years. 1920. I mean, but back in the 60s, you know, it was a 60 lot subdivision because the land was available. Right. There just isn't that kind of land. The fact that the town bought the Irvin and Tadaro and Pratt properties, you know, there's a few other big pieces that we've been looking at as a, you know, as a board and as a town over the years. You know, the YMCA property is one on the east side of Hopkinton. We did a study on the whole east side of Hopkinton. Laborers training is that. They're very happy both doing what they're doing with their areas. The west side, if you look at the west side of town, it's built. There might be a few spots. You know, there's going to be a lot of infill, maybe tear down of a smaller house downtown streets areas and build, you know, something bigger. And I think you're going to see some of that. And I think we've addressed some of the historic stuff in here, though we want to maintain some of it. And there are a few spots where you can maybe take a house lot, maybe knock the house down and build two houses, you know, with frontage. But they're just there's not, and I think we've seen it, because certainly any developer that thought they could build on big lots in Hopkinton, economically, they're going to make a lot of money. I mean, the houses are still selling pretty well here. And, yep. You know, it's, but the trend, I think, for somebody that wants to see a slower growth is much better there. Yeah. And we've also, part of the legacy deal was to limit the bedroom count so that the impact on the schools, which is really the impact on the taxpayer, if we had built that all out of the single family houses, it's not one school we'd be building, we'd be building two and three schools. I mean, that's the history of 10 years ago when that decision was being made.
Yeah. I understand.
I think, Mr. Chairman, I think to her point, Ms. Pilot's point, I think it's just being mindful. I think we are to a certain degree, but it's still, even though there's not a 40-unit facility going in, still a death by 1,000 cuts. You get 10 here, you get 3 here, all of a sudden you get 30 or 40 aggregate on an annualized basis. Because I think what you're going to find over the next 5 to 7 years is those 450 units are going to get occupied in Legacy North. All of a sudden, that volume is going to start to coagulate in a big way between the Muse and over on the west side. You've got that. It'll be very interesting how it all kind of comes to fruition.
Mm-hmm. Right? And hopefully we have a good vision on that. And then we're doing our best to maintain an ebb and flow.
Well. Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Ebb.
A lot of ebb.
Kathy, come on up.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone.
Hello.
I wanted to comment, to echo on somebody else's comment tonight. Thank you for this very comprehensive document. I think it's really important that all of these things be looked at, and thank you for the opportunity to comment on it. I know you received the letter from Lori, correct? And then did you also receive the letter from me with the most recent NASDAQ projections?
No, in fact, I did not see anything from Lori.
Okay. I have written on her letter, but I will leave it with you tonight.
Okay.
I'm sure you don't want me to read it, but there were
summarize it for us, please, and then we'll get it out to everyone, please.
Also, for our viewers at home that may not know who you are.
So Dr. Kathy McLeod, the superintendent of schools. Yes. Thank you for having me here tonight. So there were 1, 2, 5 areas that Lori commented on, and then I just wanted to update the committee on a really interesting trend. So at the top of page 16, you're commenting in your document on future development potential, and we've watched the NASDAQ projections with fascination over the past several years, particularly when we're looking at enrollment for the new building. And it is very true that we were kind of up and down, and the overall was an average of not a great concern about enrollment. However, and Elaine, I have a copy of this that I can leave with you tonight with the most recent NASDAQ projections. The comment on page 16 is that total enrollment is predicted to decline slowly over the next 10 years. And that is very true up until the most recent NASDAQ projection, which actually, and I've said in this letter, historical data provides a snapshot of the ups and downs. The projected enrollment for the next 10 years shows steady increases with a total of 316 more students, unprecedented in the past, definitely over the past 10 years, enrolled in the district in 2026. While this number is spread across the district, it's mostly at K-5, and we find that once they get here, they tend to stay, which we're very excited about. One way that we can think about this increase is that it is the equivalent of 12 to 15 additional classrooms. So one thing that I was going to ask if the committee would consider is on page 51, when you reference school size, and you're talking about square footage, I'm wondering if it would be helpful to the committee and to the community to think about that in terms of classroom spaces. When we are creating schools and when we're looking at incoming students, what we care most about is how many kids per class, and therefore how many classrooms will that mean. And we do have some spaces that we can use for different purposes. For example, at the center school, we're using the art room currently as a classroom. So we know that we can do that in ways that can manage ebbs and flows, knowing that we don't necessarily need to build wings of classrooms. We can look at some temporary solutions. But I do think it would be useful for us to think about potential capacity, so current capacity, and then anticipated enrollment with respect to the numbers of classrooms. If this is something that interests you, I'd be happy to work
great.
With you to provide it.
Yes. That'd be very useful.
A second area that Lori Nickerson, chair of the school committee, pointed out in her letter was the town building projects list. And I apologize, I couldn't find the page reference for that. But just, again, important to point out all of the building projects that that we're so excited to have in taking place in the town, to include the library, DPW facility, and Fruit Street facility. I'm very excited, and I know that you've taken on and written a letter, Mr. Chairman, about the concerns about the traffic calming initiative. We did take that up at a most recent school committee meeting, and the school committee has agreed to help to fund that study and have followed up with the town manager regarding that important issue, so that when we come to town meeting, we are hoping an engineering a plan so that people can feel that there's a solid plan in place and understand what it would cost, with the idea that we don't want this to have to wait another 2 years to address. Page 51, and again, I'd be happy to help with this if you would like. Just updating the awards references are somewhat outdated. The most recent one referring to 2006 with respect to awards and recognitions for the school department. So I'd be happy to provide that for you. And then finally, page 59, the action plan, which again, I think it's commendable, and I think it's great, and you are looking at everything, obviously, in this plan. I wondered if you would consider adding to your action plan to monitor and plan for the potential increase to enrollment. I worry about the increases in enrollment as it pertains to the potential for an additional wing, something that I'd really like to be thinking about and planning for, because additional growth is wonderful. And I think one of the things that you call out in your, at the beginning that I think is really true, and school department has always felt the support of all of the different town departments, which is sustain and support an educational system of excellence. And I know that the town is really behind that. So if there could be some recommendation under your action plan to monitor that, I think that would be a wonderful addition. Okay. So yeah. I will make sure that you get a clean copy of the letter from the chair of the Hopkinton School Committee, as well as, this was sent to the Board of Selectmen Appropriations Committee and Planning Board on November the 9th, along with an updated NASDAQ projection. So would you like me to get that to Elaine?
That would be great.
Okay.
Yeah.
We will.
And
oh, today? Huh. Okay. I mean, I'm happy to leave it. It's just that it's got the school committees, so I'll get you clean copies of both of these.
Okay.
So there was this letter from Lori Nickerson.
We never saw that.
Okay. Okay. It's not too late?
No, it's not too late.
Okay.
No.
I thought I heard that you voted.
Living document.
Living document.
We're
fabulous.
We're not ready to finalize it yet, and so we're taking a lot of input, and we'll probably have to digest it over a meeting or two. And,
sure.
And we're trying to get a lot in, and just before Kathy leaves, you know, it's all your fault that the schools are so good, the population is growing.
Well, I share the guilt with a lot of people on my team, so.
I mean, you know, that's the reason people are buying houses here, and our property values are what they are because the school school systems there. I mean, that's 90% of the thing, in my opinion. Maybe it's higher than 90%.
Thank you. We're very excited about our schools, and I just will make a shout out before I leave because I have the floor that the diversity that is coming to the town is so wonderful. We had an international night at the Hopkins School recently. There were 500 people there. Are you nodding because you were there? It was so heartwarming, and I think it's a very exciting for our town indeed. So thank you.
One more question. I have two more questions.
Go ahead, John.
You mentioned an increase of 317. Is it coming from new construction, or are we, the way you were describing it, I was also getting is that maybe houses that were larger houses that may have had empty nesters are now seeing new families coming in?
Yes. They do both. So in the projections from NESDIC, they are looking at both of those trends in their analysis.
So those empty nesters, we want to keep here longer.
Well, I guess they're moving to Legacy, right? Yeah. Oh,
it's Legacy. I mean,
pretty much, but then the places that they're leaving are getting full.
That's right. Yes. Correct. And that they do take that into consideration in their projections. So.
And I think, Elaine, our last look at Legacy, because, you know, we look at where we are plan-wise, we're slightly ahead maybe on the number of students that we expected, but not alarmingly.
Have not exceeded at all, right?
Yeah, they're in the planning range, I mean, for where students are. I suspect that the Muse, which is the 40B, it was marketed and built, you know, they have a playground in their property. It is going to be much more of there's a lot of three-bedroom units over there. That is much more of a children target, I guess. Or
yes, you know. We just budgeted for a new bus for you know, as part of our school budget. We were just talking about that. So I think the planning piece is what's critical, and if we know that it's coming, we can all plan for it and be prepared to continue to offer just a wonderful, wonderful educational program in town.
And I just want to make one personal comment too. I know district was a divisive thing for the town, but I just love the fact that the new school is in the center of the town, that everybody comes to the center of the town, and I know the kids, they loved it themselves, you know, and I think Hopkins is unique in that way. Not many other towns have two grades of the entire town, and two grades of the entire town.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It is very unique.
I don't like the fact that the restaurants are in the town. I know there's problems with traffic and stuff like that, yeah. But it's nice to come together as a community.
I would just like to know how what's the expectations for the football team on Thursday?
I will not comment on that.
That's funny,
so.
When I'm thinking, I don't think it's sports. But yes, it's part of it.
It is very much part of it. Just a well-rounded...
When are you going to start up a cricket team?
I can't answer that. We just started up a ski team, so we'll have to see about cricket.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think Vincent has got the action item for one of our goals for Hayden Royal Project. So we'll be working with that, and thank you for your support on that.
Right.
We're thinking about Central Artery Connecting.
No.
Central Artery.
No. Oh, I like
bridge.
That.
We're going to do a bridge over the road.
That's great.
Traffic bridge to get over the road.
That's great. Well, I'll get those letters to you and those numbers, et cetera, capacity. I'll get all that, too.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Ken, if I can talk to the table for a sec.
Okay. Well, let's make sure we don't have too many more folks that want to. I mean, this hearing is to get the public stuff, and then we'll talk. All the way back again, please. It's Peggy, right?
Just hearing people talk about the roads and improving the downtown street and having it be unsafe walking on certain roads. There's one thing that is just, I know it's just a major societal ill, but since I live in this town, if we could just have some kind of commitment to start enforcing the speed limit and make the roads themselves safer and saner And it would just instantly make everything more pleasant and a better place to live. I mean, Main Street is like a truck run, and there's people speed right by the police station. Hayden Row, where I pull out, my heart's in my mouth. There's not a day that goes by. So I don't know how we would even implement that to somehow involve the policemen or
have an answer.
Have some kind of,
I've had a conversation with the chief about this, and what they're looking for are people that are concerned, and especially in the neighborhoods, where you volunteer, where they can park in your driveway or something, where they just need to know, they need feedback from people where they think the worst situations are.
I drive any time.
And I was told in my neighborhood, a lot of my neighbors say, well, I don't want you really being in my driveway, so the police get a little bit frustrated because they can't be exactly where they need to be to help slow the situation down.
Did she just stop in or email them?
They're very open to conversations about this.
Chief Lee's wonderful to talk to. If you want to talk to him, he'll be happy to.
I mean, right in front of the police station, people have the gall to be going 45 and the speed limit's 30. So put the radar out. Put those little.
Verify that on Wood Street, they're there parked at least once every other night.
Yeah.
I
anyway,
drive by all the time.
That's kind of an overview I have. That sure. I'm scared every time I get on the road, and that would greatly improve my love of this, my appreciation of this town, if I could feel safer walking, riding a bike, or just even driving. So that's just a thought.
More public. Ken, come on back. Go ahead. And then.
I'm Ken Parker, 69 Clinton Street. What I'm saying now is kind of prompted by earlier comments about the town not having all the information it might want, and that this is a useful document to provide that. And since it's, I guess, still an open document, that means there's still opportunity to put in more facts. So two things come to mind. Recently, at the CPC meeting, it became obvious that some of the residents of the town don't know that in last town meeting, we voted to have a dog park built on the Hughes property. So on page 58 is, so far as I know, the only reference to a dog park. I thought it might be, I'm not a big advocate of the dog park. I don't want to speak in favor of it, but I do think this is a valuable document to for people in the town to know what we're up to. And since that was voted at last town meeting, I think we ought to at least reference that vote as something that's underway, so that when residents of the town read about the master plan, they know what has already been done. And I know that there are people that aren't happy about it, that didn't know about it because they didn't go to town meeting. But if what I'm saying here is that if you read this document, you would have no clue that at town meeting that vote had taken place. Similarly, there's a section, New Town Property, on page 18. It would seem reasonable to me that at least some place in the document, and perhaps that's the place, but it need not be and maybe it's not the best place, and I may have missed it, but it might be worthwhile to explain to the public the CPC process and how that works for buying new open land. And right now it talks about Pratt Street and the Scout House elementary schools, but it doesn't describe any of the other parcels of land that were recently bought. It seems perhaps there is an opportunity to inform the public once again as to what has been done. And also, this is to be a forward-thinking document, is my understanding. It seemed reasonable to kind of make reference to the fact that we may buy more property in the future and explain how that would take place if it were to take place.
Okay. Thank you. Other folks? Okay. Cliff, you had something you wanted to talk about.
Yes, please. While everybody's still here, Elaine, if I may direct this over to you, on West Main Street, before the 495 underpass where I live at 86, we have it marked on our land use 2014 map. On the left side of Lumber Street, we have my property over to Mobile as commercial. And then on the right side of Lumber Street, on the left side of West Main Street going towards Main, we have it in blue as a medium density residential. That is no longer the case and was not even at 2014. That is all commercial. So
what page?
Huh?
It's the map.
It's on the map. Okay, so
map in our notes. Okay, yep.
When we look at that particular map itself,
well,
it indicates,
Cliff, I think the difference is this is how the land's being currently used as opposed to how it's zoned, and none of those units over there have been rebuilt as commercial, though they are zoned at this point.
Right.
I think that might be the explanation.
In 2014. The only reason why I bring this up is because there's change going to be coming there.
Oh, yeah.
And that's not going to look like that.
Yep.
And Ken had mentioned on several occasions how when we change things up in the center of town, they're not going to look the same. We're going to have higher buildings, or we're going to have more of this, or we're going to have more of that. Well, we've got that area down there, which is the mecca of things going on right now. And that's going to look a lot different as these older folk residents now move to Legacy or move out of town. Those things are going to change. And that commercial use space is going to envelop that area.
Okay. Let's go through some of the written comments that we've got. Let me take the first one, which is a edit to page 50, which was from the senior center, and there was some clear edits of what they thought the wording changes were. Did anyone have any questions on that? To me, it was very clear. One of the things is that we probably should have caught is that instead of using the word elderly, the senior was the preferred nomenclature. So I guess
so noted, Mr. Chairman.
What?
So noted.
Yeah. Another comment that was also from the senior center was the need for transportation for disabled and senior citizens. And maybe we can feed that into the transportation section a little bit more. I honestly think, and this is the committee that Elaine and I are on for the regional transport. We had a regional transportation. At that committee, I said, you know, what's the impact of these driverless cars in, I'll say, 5 to 10 years? It's significant, I think, for the senior citizens because they will be able to call up Uber and get a car that just stops in their front yard and take them. You know, I'm hoping that when I'm in my 90s, I'll still be driving, but I won't be driving, and the car will be driving itself safely down the street and not hitting people. But and I'm a long way from the 90s, but hopefully. So anyway, that comment, maybe we can feed that one in too. Historic District Commission gave us one where they gave us four recommendations. One is that the natural, cultural, and open space section add language that describes the historic districts in greater details and explains the role of the historic district commissions. And then add an action item that recommends a study of the town to expand the Hopkinton Center Historic District. That'll be an interesting one. And then another action item recommendation that the amount of green space and planning within downtown shall be increased. I think that's kind of maybe add that into where we talk about the downtown corridor. I think that's pretty well set.
Yeah.
I won't say in stone yet, but and that was an intentional pun. And then the last is the which is another way the traffic sign audit in downtown before the corridor gets done there to minimize the number of signs that get planted in that area. Maybe we can put those items into that area. And then we had one from Mavis O'Leary. I'm trying to remember whether Mavis was on the last master plan committee or not. Was she on the visioning group?
She was
on visioning, yeah. Okay. Basically, a couple short list of comments after saying that we did some pretty good stuff. She kind of talks a little bit about the trails and open space. Planning for a community center with indoor pool and athletic facilities. Linkage of trails and bike paths, which we've already kind of talked about tonight. An overlay map of all the trails would be useful in here. We could potentially put whatever we have in that area. An overlay map of wildlife corridors might be useful. We'd have to create something. And then, okay, that I think summarizes Mavis's comments.
The only comment I would make is, and I think we spoke about this in one of our previous meetings, the maps are not really readable.
Yep.
On our copy, so what can we do to...
We've got to make them bigger.
One.
We don't have maps yet, so they're still...
Yeah, work in progress.
But it'd be like a one-page type thing?
Yes, there would just be one...
That is legible.
Hopefully.
Mr. Chairman, a question, or really a point of order. Who's going to then take these comments from both Mavis as well as the Historic Commission? And are they going to be incorporated, or are they out for discussion, or what's the...
Well, we could, if there's no serious objection tonight, we will task Elaine and Jennifer to kind of merge it in there, and then we will have further discussion in the next meeting or one of our following, you know, meetings to kind of really go through it before we're ready to portion. If there's sections that we really didn't like, maybe we don't waste the time on it. But I haven't seen any that are terrible yet.
No, I think some are common sense, right? They should definitely be added in there. A couple others probably worth some discussion. And maybe if they're added into the document, almost like in Word, where you kind of see the edits.
Yes.
Pull out a couple of those points. Again, a few of these, like the ones in Mavis, the last couple, no-brainers, right? Just add them. But a couple of the other ones, just say, hey, this is a worthy of discussion. That's all.
Put everything in, highlight it for your discussion.
Yeah, change the font. Just change. Change.
And also, you know, the verbal comments we received tonight, too.
Same.
Yeah,
absolutely, Mr. Chairman.
Now, the... Come on.
Hey. Amy Roderbush, 54 Grove Street, Chair of the Historic District Commission for the Center District. If you had specific questions about the things we added, I'm happy to try to answer those or take the questions back to my board. Or for you to think about it.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Sorry.
You speak up a little bit more.
Okay. If you had specific questions about the things we asked to be added to the plan, I'm happy to try to answer those tonight. Or take information back to the board.
And that's from the Historic Commission?
Yeah.
I thought they were pretty clear. I mean, the action plan for particularly increasing the Center Historic District, I don't have a problem with the action item. I think you're going to have a hard time.
Sure, I think we understand.
Working with each of the property owners, but and maybe that's why I probably smiled a little bit at it, because I think that's a tough one. That's a tough sell.
I think we agree, but it's the district is very spotty. Like that, it'll be one building and then not the next building, and then it will be the next building. And if the property owners are agreeable, I think we would like to try to join some of the areas. Okay.
And I like the green space one. There's some more green space, I think, in the plan as I've seen the corridor.
It's to be determined.
But it's still being worked upon. I mean, I think there's the street is very wide right here where it's across from the library, and I know there's a lot more green space in front of the library in the plan. A little bit more green space, I think, down by the common, you know, but it's we're also trying to fit kind of another row and a 10 feet of bike lane through that whole thing.
Yeah.
So it's I think it's kind of tough.
Yep.
I mean, yeah. Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very for
thank
coming.
You.
Thanks, Amy.
Not a bad idea at all. Then we have one from the Board of Selectmen. This is kind of the last one we'll kind of do there. They had 5 points. Facilities and services provide guidance on governance in line with the vision statement and need for more cooperation in future, such as town government must deal with increasing complex cross-jurisdictional issues, include discussion of the charter and how it will deal with these issues. Boy, that's a tough one. I mean, and I'm not so sure that that isn't above our pay grade, but we'll have to all give some thought to that one. Implementation plan should identify responsible parties for each action plan and how it will be funded. The first one, I think we might be willing to put a responsible name to it, but for each one of those action plans. However, when I was a manager, I always made sure that the person I was making responsible for that actually accepted the responsibility before it was solidified. So that will, if we go ahead and do that, that means kind of another round, which takes another month or two out of the thing, which might not be the worst thing in the world. And it might be a lot better if, you know, this particular item is planning board's responsibility. And, you know, that's easy to do that. But when we say, hey, that's up to the Board of Selectmen, and if they say no, well, then we'll have to come up with somebody else to do it. Or maybe they'll say, we ain't going to do it. And it's truly their responsibility.
So that's where that number one crosses over to number two.
Yes, it does. And how items are going to be funded, to me, it's got to be a general statement, because you can't, you know, we have a capital, maybe we talk a little bit about the procedure. Some of the areas where people have been talking about, you know, how does CPC kind of work to fund stuff? Well, how does our capital improvements committee, how does our budget process work in a paragraph? You know, because I don't think we're trying to redo anything of that. Sure, the plans action are consistent with that, and that further sustainability and energy conservation objections of the town visit. I guess we should put some words in to talk about it, but I thought we kind of had something in that area, but maybe that's in the building facilities area that we talk about being a green community and how we want people to plan on that. And maybe we put an area where town facilities look at Frank's subject of putting solar panels on stuff or water conservation, which is critical. And maybe we have some action items in that area. And the last one is verify that the principal assessor supports the assumption that the 80-20 split is appropriate balance. We've always talked about 80-20, and we've talked about that as kind of the goal for the last 30 years or so. And some parts we were, I think, in the early 90s, late 80s, we were 80-20-ish for a while. But
built a lot of houses.
What?
Built a lot of houses.
We built a lot of houses back then, too. And but anyway, I guess that one is verify whether the principal assessor thinks we can get there. But isn't the 2020 group goal to get to 20% by a certain range, or... I'm trying to remember what that goal is.
Ken, I think you missed number four.
Did I miss number four?
Yeah.
Well, how do services keep pace with development? That should be interesting.
Any guidance as I try to write something for that?
Be creative. I mean, obviously the schools and Kathy kind of really talked about how they're trying to do it. Water and sewer are kind of covered, but that was more in providing additional services for development in certain areas.
I think we need to have a liaison with different groups in order to get that decision. I mean, we can't make that arbitrarily because our position is just full of.
And maybe the action item is on various different organizations to.
Well, it is, and that's why I say we probably need to put some collaboration in the document that says we need to meet on a quarterly or semi-yearly basis and go over the different facilities.
But in many ways, though. That's done on the yearly budgeting process. Yeah, I mean, you know, in the school committee kind of does that. They the first thing they project is how many kids are going to have to educate the next year. You know, the fire chief justifies the number of people he's got based on, hopefully, what his fire and emergency practices are. I mean, you know, and this year there's supposed to be a bottom-up budget, I believe. Didn't I read that? I mean, to do that, you use these facts and figures and say, hey, in order to, I need three ambulance crews, or I need two, or, you know, I need to keep that hook and ladder going. And I built myself on a service from a budgeting standpoint. So I think we do a better job of it. I don't know how we forecast it when we break the bank. Because a lot of these are step changes. Anyway, go.
I was just going to say, maybe we could just call out in a section, like keeping up with services, and list each of them and say the police department is responsible within their own group to, you know, just like you just said.
But that eliminates this problem that the board gives us as number one. Community facilities and services, governance section, provide guidance on governance in line with the town's vision statement and give the need for more collaboration in the future. So to do that, what we can't just like leave it in the hands of, you know, the fire department, the police department, we need that communication going across the board. And that's what we're not doing. We're not bridging those gaps.
Well, first of all, I don't think it's the role of the planning board necessarily.
But
to
that's
be
why
doing
it's brought
that.
To us, though, Ken.
Well, no. I don't think the selectmen are ceding their responsibility for overall leadership in the town.
As I was saying, let's just document it and show who's responsible for it, not
excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, Fran.
I think you need to tie it together.
Yes.
I think that's really what
everything's
it is.
Done.
That's right. And each individual is responsible for their own piece.
Right.
It's just somehow.
Tie it together. Is correct.
Mm-hmm. Let's try to have one conversation. Elaine,
I'm just saying it all ties back to land use and development in some way. So just making a case.
Yes.
Chair. Yeah. One of the things we did, and maybe the same model can be used with other issues, was how long ago was the town buildings project that I worked on?
Oh, the
4 years ago was a long-term plan on the buildings, meeting with each of the departments and looking at each of the buildings in town and trying to make a short-term, mid-term, long-term plan for the facility based on what the occupants in that structure were thinking about, looking at the schools and trying to get a picture on that, because historically there wasn't a lot of money put into maintenance, because maintenance historically had been in the department budget as opposed to centralized in the facilities area.
Maybe we need to update that plan.
Yeah, maybe it should be updated.
We do have that. Updated implement the capital asset management plan.
Oh, okay.
The town's physical assets adequately maintained.
Tied into that, and thinking what Dr. McLeod said, is we look at an increase in population as uniformly increasing demographically by age, et cetera. And I think it may pay to look at, you know, what's happening is the increase is not, you know, what's happening with the increase? Are we getting a spike in seniors and a spike in school age and kind of lower in the middle and using that to adjust how we have to address it rather than assuming it's still going to be 20% of this group, you know, 30% of this group, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, if the 180 senior units get approved, I mean, that's probably 250 to 300 senior folks are over 55. And, you know, what services besides the ambulance are they going to use? What services, like maybe the library, the senior center? You know, that was kind of mentioned in a few of the spots. I mean, maybe not going to use the park and rec so much, but or maybe we, you know, some of us get a you know, over 55 softball team going or something, you know. Or I mean, it's
we have an over 63 soccer team.
We do. Okay. Okay. So, well, that makes sense. Okay.
Didn't I see one question about transportation?
Yes.
Yes, we talked about that. That was from...
Legacy South.
No, throughout the whole community.
Yes, that was from Amy Beck from the Senior Center, who talked about basically on-demand transportation for seniors and disabled folks. And
Lane gave them a response.
Yeah. Get more information, yeah.
Asking for more specifics. Mm-hmm.
So she did provide.
Oh, she did. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
she did reference Legacy South.
Elaine, why don't you, can you relate what we heard at that, the Suburban Edge from Ed?
Ed Carr,
the great name. He's just about to retire, named Carr, and he runs the bus service out of Framingham.
Yeah, Metro West Regional Transit Authority.
Yes.
So the problem Hopkinton has about elderly and disabled transportation is the same that, you know, most of our surrounding communities have as well. So they're working on, I think, various ways to address that. I think there's a number of things they could do. Also looking at, I think, the Senior Center in Hopkinton and the Senior Center in Milford are working together to work on some exchanges as well. So I think they're in active discussions. I don't remember any specifics that you said, but they're always looking at expanding bus routes and trying to serve people, but that kind of use doesn't serve, isn't served well by a fixed route service, so it has to be some on-demand service, and funding for those things is difficult to come by.
They're very expensive because to provide, but I have seen the vehicles that, you know, are like a small van that could take wheelchair type folks.
So could we hire? I mean, could private contractors come in to do that?
I'm sure they could. It's really the funding, because a lot of these folks also don't have the money to do it, and I have an in-law that you know will take that service, and it's, you know, it's a get a wheelchair service from here to somewhere. It's the better part of $100 for, you know, maybe the round trip. It's very expensive. So a lot of it.
They're on fixed income, many of those.
And it's a kind of, it's a tough tougher situation. Maybe our senior center, I mean, we have a couple of vans at the senior center that provide a lot of transportation for, I know they'll take the seniors from there, they'll take them down to Market Basket in Bellingham, and I believe, because I've seen them on shopping trips.
There could also be volunteers who would volunteer to help out seniors.
I remember back in our day, Ken, Gatra bus was something. Now, they would have a pickup where they could put wheelchairs on the front of the bus or back of the bus or wherever, and people could get on if they were, and that was a company that's all they did was transportation of around towns.
Well, maybe that we really need is a investigate type goal. I mean, this master plan doesn't solve the details, right, but right. Maybe. We investigate working with the regional transportation to provide that on demand. And, you know, it could be something that with a small amount of money from the community, mm-hmm. we might be able to get a vehicle dedicated towards Hopkinton area. I just don't know. Or maybe it's, you know, those are funded via... state grants, which I believe a lot of them are.
They run succinct with each other. So GATRA is one I know of for sure. GAT.
So their service area is south of here. So
right.
This is the Metro West service area, and GATRA is to the south.
Okay,
so
but they have a sister.
They don't cross over.
They don't have a sister company that for this area that we know of?
No, so each transit authority has their own separate area, and part of the problems is where they try to meet. They try to meet and exchange passengers and so forth, and it's very difficult because they're all in their separate service areas.
I mean, I think Milford is within ours, yeah. So if we can go from Hopkinton to Milford and all the way to Framingham and all the way up to, I think, Hudson, if I remember right. Westboro was...
I think one of the things we'd like to do is to have a direct connection to Milford. So once they just started their service, so once that gets established, it'd be nice to have a connection directly to Milford. Right now, if somebody wants to go to Milford, you have to go to Framingham first and then go back up.
Right.
Yeah.
But this regional guys have been adding routes, and we had also talked a little bit about with Legacy. Once Legacy is big enough, maybe there's a demand for it, but. And I think there more people are using it than in the past.
And they're the answer to getting underneath 495, right? I mean, if we had a bus take people over that bridgeway.
Yeah, we do a couple times a day.
Yeah, is that enough?
Obviously not. I mean, has anyone here ever used it, the transportation system? I don't think so. I mean, I don't think there's like very few people in Hopkinton that I think use it. But okay, I think we're about where we should be tonight.
Can I ask a question about the next steps for the master
sure.
plan? Like, I know we're going to make some updates to it, but in a previous meeting we kind of reviewed it. But we went kind of fast. Mm-hmm. I think it would behoove us to go. Through it again at a little slower pace, and I don't know what the schedule.
Our fifth of December meeting is pretty full up, but maybe in 19th of December or sometime in January we're going to be a lot. You know, I'd like to get this thing completed. As reasonably, you know, we want to get one of the goals done. One of the things I think we need to do is to take all of the action items or whatever and try to assign somebody to it and then just email those out to, you know, mm-hmm. Lane and I will take that on because who's going to do what to who and see who possibly is there or, you know.
As far as the implementation?
For the implementation, you know,
that in.
I mean, you know, we at the end of every paragraph in the action plan, we can put parentheses and a name of a committee after every one of them.
Olivia in new section, page 73, we have the placeholder for the implementation plan. We will list them all with the timeline and who's responsible.
Okay.
So, yeah. But, you know, planning 5 or 6 years out. So
sure.
Not everything can be done at once.
Yep. And, you know, the big goal is, the big, that would be a big change is just if people accepted the responsibility to work on that one. And you know, maybe we fill that implementation plan out and then send that out for comments, and then we're going to get their attention.
It's what we have in the open space plan, so it's a similar.
Okay.
Is that a picture of on top of page 44?
Western Nursery.
Yeah,
Western Nursery.
That was the original.
With that big, huge.
It's still there.
John?
Just as a kind of a follow-up, and we're talking about communications, et cetera, I think one of the things that we can do is after a planning board meeting or before a planning board meeting is to use their own social network to push out a planning board on Monday night. We don't have this coming up or that. And we all have social networks that touch but are different, and that if all of us made an effort of distributing out what's coming up or what's under discussion and did it on a regular basis, I think it would be a good way to get the information out there to the community.
Very good.
Because, you know, amongst the nine of us, we must have at least another nine people who we are friends with.
Do we have a Twitter page? The town?
The town does, yeah.
It does. Mm-hmm. So we can push out.
Okay.
You can tweet.
Yep. One of the things, if you look at the social networking pages of the town, there's not a lot of people who are linked up to them. So I that are friends or...
But we need to promote that. So
but I think if we push it out and keep on pushing it out and pushing it out, I think it'll actually get more distribution, because I think if you add it all up, how many distinct individuals, we probably have a couple of thousand.
Easy.
Almost all of us.
To your point.
The communications area is kind of... could be done a lot better and spend a lot more time on it.
Yeah.
For example, at a Water Resources Commission, there's one town that now has meters like we're just installing that can read your meter via radio. And they actually read people's meter, and they can tell, depending on... because they've linked it up as to how many kids are in the house, and they know what that person should use on a daily basis. And if their water use spikes over a day, they'll send them an email. And they work hard to collect these emails. A lot of them they get from Parks and Rec, but they want to, you know, get an email and make sure that it doesn't get through the junk filter. But basically, they can say to you, hey, do you have a leak? You know, is the toilet running? Are you illegally watering? And they also have this program that does the person, is they connected to an irrigation system with the town water? So, I mean, they really spend a lot of time, and then they also use it to send out conservation messages occasionally but targeted ones. You know, they're not going to send out the one that on irrigation unless they know you've got an irrigation system, hooked up, So anyway, that's an area that maybe...
But to your point, Cliff was talking with me tonight, you mentioned something about communications, and it spurred a thought to me that, hey, I should tell my neighborhood of this meeting tonight. So it's kind of last minute, but I sent out the last email.
Well, we've gotten a lot of information tonight. We'll still be collecting a lot of information. We like to thank everyone for all the stuff that they've provided. I think at this point we should vote to close the public hearing. That isn't to say we're going to not take more information and revise things in it, but we've kind of gone through the formal process. If we make things completely change where we need some more of this, we'll, we can always have another one if we all think that we need something. So you move, the motion is to close the public hearing. It's moved and second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. I think that we've talked about everything, unless there's any liaison reports of different committee folks. Future agenda items, of course, are always welcome, particularly where we're seeing a lot of small things at this point. No really big ones right going on, so we've got time to do real planning as opposed to reacting to permitting requirements.
I would just like to add, Ken, if I may, that all of the suggestions that came tonight from what I looked at seem to be all about the same thing, is communication was primary, and getting people involved is primary.
The key for the master plan is not to just finish it, throw it in the drawer, and be done with it. Yeah. I mean, it's a document that provides good information and then sets a framework. And if it starts to get stale, it's got to get updated. So with that, I entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. How do you vote on adjourning?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And we'll see you all on our next meeting on the whatever.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Happy
Thanksgiving.
The 5th. Yes.
You said the 5th, then they want to put on until January.